Welcome to the Public Voice Salon. We are an open dialogue on education, the arts, and social change. And today we are spending some wonderful time with Foster Hirsch, who is one of the leading film historians and film critics in the world, also a professor of film studies at Brooklyn College, where he helped to found the Department of Film Studies in the early 1970s. And Claudia and I had the great privilege and pleasure of encountering Foster in his talks that he gave at the Film Forum in New York City and also at the Jersey Lowy's, which is in Journal Square. It's an old-fashioned movie theater from the 20s that's been restored. And it is just such a great thrill to be with a man who knows so much about film, who can help us in our own contemplation of and pondering of the works of film art that have meaning in our lives. One of the quotes that I like to say on our show is from John Dewey, who was a great education philosopher, who said that the more you know about a work of art, the more you see what's there to be seen and to be noticed. And so the job of the critic or the film critic and historian, when we're watching a movie ourselves, now we can more, you know, better able to see and grapple with what's there. And he brings that level of language and articulation. He's one of the great film speakers in the world. Foster has gone around the world speaking at film conferences. And I think one of these days you're going to see him with Robert Osborne on TCM, which is another great show that Claudia and I like to watch. So getting knowledge about film is important, and this is a show about education. So we're going to just start by giving you the microphone, Foster, and talk about what it is about film that you have learned over the years and how it communicates to people. It's been said that film is one of the most powerful art forms of our time, whereas, you know, way back in the past you had paintings where, you know, back in the Middle Ages it was that was the art form du jour, and in the 20th century and the 21st century it's film, or maybe we're moving in a different area in the 21st century. Certainly the 20th century, film was it. What was it that attracted you to film as a young man, and what is it that has placed film at the center of your life?
Actually, when I was very young, I don't think I liked films. I wish I knew the film where that changed. But as a small kid, my parents were moviegoers, so I was taken a lot. And at first I resisted it. And then at a certain age, it wasn't until about 8 or 9, I know film historians who love movies from 4 and 5. But for me, it was, I think it was about 9 or 10. And then something happened, and I loved the form, the storytelling, the imagery. And I didn't know that I was going to dedicate my professional life to it, but then the opportunity happened, and I was happy to do it. I've been at Brooklyn College for 48 years now, still there, and I was there at the college before there was a film program. And then once I had been publishing on film, and they asked me to come over from the English department to teach some courses in film, and of course I said yes right away. And then I gradually got away from English and full-time in film, and I've been there ever since. And I think, just as you say, wow, my job as a teacher and a writer and a historian is to alert people to what I see in the work and maybe help them to see more in film than they might be able to see for themselves. And it's not about sharing my opinion, but this is what I see, this is what to look for. Whether you agree with me or not, keep an open mind and see if you see what I'm suggesting that you look at. So it's just to help you to see more. It's not to convert you to share all of my opinions. My opinions are my own, they're idiosyncratic. I don't always go along with the canon. These are the great films, these are the not so great films. I sometimes like to champion the films that have been underappreciated or overlooked, in my opinion.
Because people do get very excited or opinionated about films and films that mean a lot to them, and they'll say, this is a great film, and other people say, well, maybe it's not such a great film. So this idea of arguing about film, I guess in one way it's good to have the passion, but then I think there's it's also good to sort of sit back and be more analytical and reflective about what is the elements of the film that come alive for you. And I remember actually, because we're in Greenwich Village right now, I want people to know that. We're on West 12th Street, and one of the great neighborhoods in the world for art and for bohemian culture and for film culture as well. We have like a half a dozen great world-class movie theaters here in the village, including the Film Forum, the Quad, the Cinema Village, which is on this block, one block away. And I remember when I started to come alive intellectually and also to art, it was this neighborhood, and in particular it was through film and going to places like the Quad and the Film Forum and overhearing people discussing the film. That was a new thing for me. You know, when you go to the Cineplex in Paramus, New Jersey, you don't necessarily hear these conversations, but at the Quad and at the Film Forum, people take the work so seriously that they engage in discussion about it. Talk about that. Talk about the process of talking about film.
I think that's part of what I do is to get people to talk about the movie. And it's not. I always tell students, your grade is based on not whether or not you agree with the teacher, but how well you defend your own point of view and your own interpretation. If you make a good case for a film that I might not like or appreciate, but your argument is well based and well written and articulated clearly, you get the good grade. It's not about agreeing with the teacher. You know, it's not about establishing consensus. It's about, I've trained you to look for certain things in movies. Can you defend what you see? And I've had students who have disagreed with me and written wonderful papers and essays on films that I didn't particularly like or understand, but they get it. And they made a case for it, clearly. They were looking for things that I taught them to look for, and that's what works. And that's the kind of conversation you see at the Film Forum, where people take the movie so seriously and debate its themes or its visual style or its directorial approach.
Well, I have to confess that at first I felt a little intimidated about engaging in conversations about film, and particularly places like the Film Forum, because everyone there is so smart. And I thought to myself, I'm going to have to learn more about film if I'm going to really appreciate it more and to be able to have intelligent discussions about film. So that's how reading about film and reading books about film. Now, you've written 25 books on film, 12 books on film.
I think it's 15.
Okay.
A big one now.
Okay. Talk about your writings about film, and I think, from what I understand, you're writing about the films of the 1950s and the films that you grew up watching. What was it about? What particular types of films? Was it the widescreen, panoramic, color, you know, epic films? You wrote about epic films. Tell us about the particular films that really spoke to you in the 50s.
I'm happy to talk about it because I've been working on this project now for a few years, and people say, well, when is your book on Hollywood in the 50s going to be finished? When it's done.
Okay.
When it's done. It's a huge project. I want it to be really good.
Okay.
But just as you said, John, the period attracted me because I grew up in the 50s. That's my decade. And I first began to fall in love with movies and to take movies seriously in the 50s. So when CinemaScope first appeared, I was there. When 3D first appeared, I was there. When Cinerama opened, I was there. And so I think I can bring something to that subject that a younger historian recreating the period can't do, because I know the impact of those films at the time. And as the decades go by and filmmaking changes, it seems to me that the 50s were among the richest and most worthwhile, among that the films of that period are among the best that we've ever had in this country. And I want to celebrate their excellence. Doesn't mean every film in the 50s was great, of course not. But I would argue that even the junk of the period is more interesting than the junk of today.
Goodness gracious. Well, something that happened in the 1950s, which you write about in this book, Method to Their Madness, The History of the Actor's Studio, is that this type of acting known as method acting, which originally was developed going all the way back to the 1890s by this guy Stanislavski from Russia, and you get into that in this book. You give a whole history of how this whole method acting began in the theater with Stanislavski and his relationship with Chekhov, who was a writer who wrote in a very naturalistic style, and that developed into this sort of more emotional method of acting, sort of against the artificial, stiff theatricality of the 19th century, where they get up on stage and declaim, and it was sort of going in and inner. And then it was Lee Strasberg who took that from Stanislavski and took the method forward, but it wasn't. And originally, the method theoreticians were very anti-film. They were very focused on the theater. But it was in the 50s that Elia Kazan brought the method acting to the masses via cinema, in particular with James Dean and Marlon Brando. Talk a little bit about what that was and why the method acting was so revolutionary for that time.
The method acting, yeah, just as you said, became popularized through the films of Kazan in the 50s. Yeah. And it, what was it? It was a style of acting, and it's a style. Yes. And it's a technique that actors train in that had a deeper emotional life and more of a sense of a character's inner life than the normal studio style acting. It was deeper, it was richer emotionally, and it was often about not what is said, but what is felt beneath what is said. So when you mentioned Chekhov, his work was the perfect perfect studio for studying the Stanislavski technique, because it isn't so much what Chekhov's characters say, it's what they don't say. And it's that silence between the spoken and the unspoken. So it's the subtext, what's beneath the words, the feeling, the truth beneath the words. And that's what method actors are trained to do, regardless of the part that they're working on. You don't have to be working on Chekhov, but right. Chekhov was the ideal laboratory. So Tennessee Williams, too. The characters are so rich. So that what's the emotional life, not only in the words, but beneath the words. And the method actor is trained to develop a style where his or her own inner life and emotional history are brought to the character. So finding emotional equivalence between what the character's experiencing and what they've experienced in their own lives. So it's a method of bringing a kind of emotional truthfulness and depth to the character and the part. Nobody was better at it than Marlon Brando, our greatest actor, I would say. And his performances in Streetcar Named Desire and On the Waterfront were truly revolutionary. And every actor who's trying to be truthful and naturalistic and real in movies today owes a debt of gratitude to the example set by Brando. He's the foundation. He's the source. Kazan himself, who knew something about good acting, called Brando a genius. So that the style of acting in the best movies of the 50s, and I include Kazan's movies at the top of the list, really represented something new in movie acting. As you said, the original people thought had a prejudice against the movies. It turns out that the method is an ideal technique for movie acting.
Well, I want to go to your text now. I want to go to the text of this book that you wrote in 1984. And I want to read two brief excerpts just to give us something to think about here. The first has to do with Brando and Dean, okay? And the kind of vulnerability that they brought, the openness that they brought, the depth and the complexity. Using their voices as naturally as they did their bodies, they sounded like real people. Brando's fabled mumble in A Streetcar Named Desire and On the Waterfront turned out to be an act. But James Dean, with his thick Midwestern twang and his slurred delivery, really didn't speak well. The inarticulate style they made famous, whether feigned or real, was a signal that words were inadequate to convey the tangle of inner feelings. Their war with words, the failed struggle toward verbal expression that became an emblem of a generation, told us in effect that they had emotions that went deeper than language. To instinctive characters like Terry Molloy in On the Waterfront and Jim Stark in A Rebel Without a Cause, words were hard to come by and not to be trusted because they usually didn't honor the full complexity of feelings. Now, in an historical analysis of the 1950s, which was the Eisenhower era of conformity, you could almost see a political meaning of this, of movies that were showing a greater sense of realness, getting away from artificiality, where at the same time there was bubbling up in the consciousness this sort of movement towards truth and a distrust of language, a distrust of adults, of the squares. How did this feed into maybe even what came later in the 1960s with the counterculture?
Well, I think that's a very valid point. One of the cliches of the 50s is that everything, as you say, the conformity and everything, suburban life, and everybody was content and there were no problems. Of course, that's a cliche and a myth, and no decade is ever just like that. But the 50s had an extraordinary other text, which was the text of rebellion and emotional pain and vulnerability, the influence of Freud, so that psychologically and emotionally, the period was an extremely charged one, and there was so much going on beneath the level of words and beneath the cliches of Eisenhower contentment. Sure, the country was economically in better shape than it had been, but there was another reality, this counter-reality, which very much led to the counterculture of the 60s. The birth of the 60s is in the 50s. And in the 50s and in the rebellious stances of actors like Brando and Dean, who did not conform to the image of Eisenhower ease and comfort. They represented something else, and audiences responded to that something else. They were against the norm, and their emotional reality was more complex than the cliches that we impose on the 50s. Of this was a time of everybody was so happy and the perfect family. Father knows best. That was the image that was pervaded on television in wonderful shows like Father Knows Best, but mythic, made up. Wasn't the reality. The reality in the Kazan films emotionally was closer to the truth of the country than the mythic image of the Anderson family in Father Knows Best. I love that show. Wow. But it wasn't real.
Oh, my goodness gracious. Well, I have to confess to you now also that I am nervous talking to you because you represent such an amazing talent and knowledge of film. You may be one of the most important film historians in the world, I think. Well, no, I know. Okay. But I will say this, that you've been speaking around the world, sir. You've been speaking in Europe and Switzerland. Tonight you're going to be at the Film Forum, and then you're dashing off to Journal Square in Jersey City to present a film there. I mean, you are on the go and on the move. You've been in several documentaries about film, okay? So I want to also confess that I am the son of a projectionist.
What?
So I grew up going to movies for free, where my dad would be up in the booth. There's my dad. He makes the movie go, okay? And so I grew up watching films, immersed in the culture of film. Not only that, my dad was a former actor when he was a young man, and he was in a play with Warren Beatty called Compulsion. The play where Beatty was discovered by Joshua Logan, who was in the audience, and Joshua Logan was friends with William Inge, who was looking for an actor for his latest film, which was Splendor in the Grass.
Kazan,
there you go.
Yeah.
So my dad was not discovered, but Beatty was, and I come from that sort of background. My dad later became an activist. So he went from being an actor to an activist. So for me, this whole idea of acting and activism and social justice is very tangled up. And whenever my dad talks about, you know, the fact that he was in a play directed by Chester Morris, who was one of those, you know, stars from the 30s, you know, wanted my dad to come on the road with K Mutiny Court Martial. My dad said no to that. But in looking back, because he had gotten married, he wanted to be a stable married man. He would always say, when talking about the fact that he could have, you know, went to Hollywood, he would say, I could have been a contender. I could have been a contender, that famous Marlon Brando remark. Now, you write about Brando and On the Waterfront that This is a film about the birth of moral conscience. Terry Molloy, working for a mob-infiltrated union, okay? Claudia and I live in Hoboken, so this resonates with us, because, you know. And you say that this was a film about thinking itself, that we see in Terry Molloy somebody who, first he's just sort of going along with the program, you know, doing what he has to do, but then he starts to come and go against the grain, and eventually he testifies about the mob. Talk about that, because that's a strong political meaning.
That's it. What you say about Waterfront, which I think is the greatest film, in my opinion, the greatest decade in Hollywood filmmaking. So it doesn't come better than On the Waterfront, in my opinion. But it is very much about the birth of a moral consciousness, because the character at the beginning of the film really hasn't thought about much and doesn't see much. By the end of the film, he sees who he is. Very much so, that great scene that you already referred to in the taxi cab, yeah. I could have been a contender, which is, to my mind, the greatest scene of self-recognition that I know of. But once he sees who he is, then he makes a choice to testify against the mob-controlled union and the mob boss, the criminal. He really is a criminal, the Johnny Friendly character. And he testifies. But if you put that testimony, which is presented as a good thing, and you connect it to Kazan's personal history and the personal history of the screenwriter, Bud Schulberg, both of whom were friendly witnesses during the House on Un-American Activities Committee's investigations into alleged communism in Hollywood. Kazan and Schulberg had been communists. They both became extremely disaffected with both the Soviet Union, where communism was a complete disaster, and with the techniques and procedures of communists. They hated communism. They did think there were communists in Hollywood, and they cooperated with the committee by saying, I was a communist, I am no longer. They didn't want to, but the committee forced them to name names. That was the committee's fault. They didn't want to do that, but they did. And they have been vilified ever since for naming names. They gave them names that the committee already had. It was a terrible ritual that the committee forced its witnesses to do. It's the committee's fault. It's not their fault. They could have said, I won't name names, and many people did that, and many people think that was the honorable stance, and what they did was dishonorable. But they did cooperate with a congressional committee. On the Waterfront is the story about a cooperation of a witness with a congressional committee. And when Terry Molloy testifies, that is the right thing to do. Is that then a metaphor for a kind of explanation of Brando, of Kazan, and Strulberg saying, you see, we did the right thing too? It has that political implication. I think at the time, Kazan and Strulberg were reluctant to say that, but it's there. It's there. This is a film about the importance of testifying. They testified.
Right. You know, there's so much to cover here. That's one of my dilemmas in interviewing you, is I have so much interest in your work and the films that you've examined, and in so many areas, whether it's film noir. You wrote a whole book on Woody Allen. I'm a huge Woody Allen fan, you know. But let's just stay one more couple of minutes with the method acting thing, and talk about Pacino a little bit. You mentioned Pacino, that in The Godfather, when he goes from being someone who didn't want to be involved with the family business to becoming the mafia kingpin, you say that you can see that through his eyes. It's all in his eyes. And that in the method, it's the objects that are important. It's the movements and the gestures that are important. Then you talk about also Scorsese and De Niro, how with Raging Bull, they wanted to out method Kazan and Brando. Do you think that was effective in terms of Raging Bull, and in terms of as an artifact of method acting greatness?
both Scorsese and De Niro were very influenced by On the Waterfront. And in some ways, their film is sort of an homage to it. Scorsese is a film historian. He could really do what I do. He could teach courses in film history. He appreciates the 50s in particular. He appreciates The Robe and the epics of the 50s, films you wouldn't think that he would. And he's a great collector. He's a great friend to film historians and collectors and archivists. And he has an extraordinary collection of prints of his own. So he's a filmmaker who's aware of film history. And among his heroes are Brando and Kazan. I see Raging Bull as a kind of tribute to On the Waterfront. It is an extraordinary film. I think it's his greatest, Scorsese's greatest film and De Niro's greatest performance. A black and white film in the 80s that sort of looks like On the Waterfront, and the acting style, and it's a style again, is very similar to On the Waterfront. So it is certainly a tribute and an homage. Did they do better than Brando and Kazan? No. They did not. You're not going to top Brando and Kazan. They did a great job, but they did not do better than the actor and the director they both revere. No, they did not. If that's the test, they failed. Did they make a good film? Yeah, it's a great film. Is it as good as On the Waterfront? No.
Okay, I hope Martin Scorsese's not watching this. But anyway, let's do justice to the women method actors, actresses now, okay? Marilyn Monroe, you said, always wanted that kind of acting depth and complexity. She hated being typecast as a dumb bimbo. She came to New York. She wanted to study with Strasberg. I love it how you say she had such a respect for Strasberg that she tiptoed into his house. The first time she went into his apartment, she tiptoed in and she tiptoed out. And in Bus Stop, you know, she has that, her greatest acting role, per se, you know. And then there were also Kim Stanley, who's an actress who I'm not familiar with her work. She only made a couple of movies. But talk about some of the great female method actresses, including Anne Bancroft and Shelley Winters.
Yeah. The names you're mentioning are actresses who studied with Strasberg at the studio and who believed in him very much. That it goes back to when Kazan co-founded the studio in 1947 with producer Cheryl Crawford and director Robert Lewis. Strasberg didn't join the studio until 1949. He's not one of the co-founders, but then he gradually took over and he became associated with the studio. Actor Studio Strasberg synonymous. But in the earliest classes then were, if we're talking about the women, Julie Harris, Ann Jackson, married to Eli Wallach, early on Geraldine Page, Kim Stanley, Kim Hunter, who was in Streetcar Named Desire, Carol Baker, who was in magnificent in Baby Doll and discovered at the studio, Shelley Winters, Geraldine Page, and then moving up to the present, Ellen Burstyn, who's co-artistic director of the studio as we speak, Estelle Parsons, Lee Grant, they all moderate there to this day. So there's a terrific tradition of female performers connected with the studio. And they all studied the work of working on the inner life of the character and also their own inner life. And how do you connect your own inner life to the inner life of the character you're playing? That's the work of the studio. And their work is extraordinary. Now, some of the actresses that we mentioned, Julie Harris and Kim Stanley, are known, Geraldine Page too, really, are known primarily as stage performers. That they didn't have the glamour of the Hollywood movie star, required for the Hollywood movie star. Brando and Dean did have the glamour. Julie Harris and Geraldine Page didn't. Great actresses, and their first loyalty was to the stage. But they made some wonderful films. You look at Julie Harris in East of Eden, directed by Kazan. Extraordinary work. Yeah, or Geraldine Page in the plays of Tennessee Williams, Summer and Smoke, and Sweet Bird of Youth. So that their best work probably is in the theater, but we get glimpses of it in film. If your viewers don't know the work of Kim Stanley, who often was said to be the female Marlon Brando, the films that they need to see are The Goddess, written by Patty Chayefsky, in which she plays a character sort of based on Marilyn Monroe, and Seance on a Wet Afternoon, in which she plays a medium. And in both, you can see the extraordinary inner work, the depth of feeling that is created through her work. With her characters, the emotion, as with James Dean, as with Marlon Brando, seems so raw and so truthful and so tangled and so complex. Nothing is simple. You know, everything is very complicated. Great deal of suffering.
Oh, my goodness. One of my own acting heroes is Al Pacino, growing up watching movies like Dog Day Afternoon, The Godfather, and a film called Injustice for All was one of my favorite movies also, where Lee Strasberg plays his grandfather, who he goes to visit at a nursing home once a week. And, you know, and he says all the time, Strasberg says, oh, is it another week already? It's another week already. This is a very tender relationship between a grandfather and a grandson, where he says, and he kisses Strasberg in the film, and he says, you're the reason I'm a lawyer today. And because he's playing a lawyer, Al Pacino, in the movie. But you can see there's a subtext there. There's a love between a teacher and his, you know, student there. And also, you mentioned in your book that it was Pacino who insisted that Lee Strasberg be given a role in Godfather Part II as Hyman Roth. And you give a wonderful analysis of that character and how Hyman Roth was really Strasberg being Strasberg to a certain extent, because he always had that kind of gravitas, but you were always afraid that he might, you know, he could also snap too. You know, there was that underneath that anger that could explode, but on the surface is a genteelness. Talk a little bit about the Pacino Strasberg relationship.
You can see it in The Godfather and in Justice for All, and you also feel it in the relationship with Robert De Niro in The Godfather. So that it's as if we're seeing actors playing parts, but we're also seeing a legendary acting teacher acting with his students. So it has a kind of double text to it. The real life text, which gets, as you said, it gets into the movies. You can feel it. It's not just Al Pacino and Lee Strasberg in the parts that they're playing. It's Al Pacino with respect for his revered acting teacher, Robert De Niro with respect for his revered acting teacher. And it's interesting, Robert De Niro and Lee Strasberg both nominated for the Oscar, and the student won and the teacher didn't, because Godfather. They're both nominated.
Okay, yes.
And Robert De Niro won, Strasberg didn't. Strasberg could have won. But I think as Strasberg playing Hyman Roth, as you say, was very like Strasberg at the Actors Studio. There was a masked quality about Hyman Roth, as there was to Strasberg. This mask, what was beneath the mask, you knew something was. That what you were seeing was just the top layer of something very much going on inside. And what that was, you weren't quite sure. With Hyman Roth, you get the feeling of, this is a criminal. Now, Lee Strasberg was not a criminal, but Lee Strasberg was a very complicated man, so that the surface concealed great wellsprings and depths of feeling. And you get that with Hyman Roth. He's just giving you just a suggestion of the person, but you feel beneath that, there's a great, rich, complicated, and with Hyman Roth, dangerous subtext. We're dealing with a very dangerous criminal. You know, great cruelty. That isn't what comes across on the surface.
Yeah. He's a kindly married man.
Seems
eating dinner from a tray.
Grandfatherly.
Yeah, sure.
But
yeah.
A grandfather who's a killer.
Birthday party.
Yeah. Grandfather who's a killer. So fascinating to see Lee Strasberg, who was famously masked. Sometimes students were intimidated by him because they didn't know what was beneath that mask. They knew something was there. He wasn't letting them see it. How did he think about us? What did he feel about us? You don't quite know. They didn't quite know. I think it was a ploy by Strasberg to keep the actors a little bit tense and to make them get into the work. He wasn't going to give them easy support. the relationship between Strasberg and the students at the studio is a very complex one. And that complexity is revealed in the parts that you're talking about with his students.
I want to segue a little bit now over to something more lighthearted, but also deeply intellectual, which is the film work of Woody Allen, another one of my favorite filmmakers. As an English professor, which is what I am, that's my day job when I'm not working on the TV show, and I'm actually segueing from being a teacher in the classroom to being an educator on the air with the show. That's really the nature of this program. It's an open dialogue on education, art, and social change. So really it's the pedagogical aspect of the show. The film that I like to show my students is a Woody Allen film called Husbands and Wives, which I think is just an incredibly innovative film where you also have an element of psychoanalysis because the characters are looking off camera at somebody who's asking them questions. There's the complexity of married life, of relationships, and there's the element of literature involved because the main character, his name is Gabe, professor at Columbia. He's also a short story writer, and there's references to Dostoevsky throughout the film. Is there a quality missing now in our film culture? Because we're talking now about a lot of intellect and a lot of thinking, whether it's method acting or whether it's the films of Woody Allen. Where are we heading now in terms of the films, the quality of films? I know I'm sort of skipping from one thing to another, but it almost makes me long for a time where films had greater resonance in terms of intelligence and thoughtfulness. Do you think we're moving past that?
Oh, for sure.
Okay.
For sure.
You're in a story.
For sure.
Okay.
But I don't teach contemporary films ever.
Okay.
Ever.
Okay.
And I see them once in a while when my students force me to. But I'm the last thing of an expert on what's going on right now. I can tell you what was going on in the 50s and the 60s, but I can't tell you much. But I know enough to say, and I would agree with you, that there's been a horrible dumbing down process. And that there, I've seen enough to know that there are terrible cliches in contemporary filmmaking, where the camera never sits still. There's very, very few dialogue scenes. It's all action, and the cutting is rat-tat-tat staccato editing, because people suffer from attention deficit syndrome. We're all inundated with imagery and sounds with the internet. And impatience.
Yeah.
Remember when you had to just sit, the camera sits, and you had to listen to actors deliver dialogue. And the camera doesn't do anything. And there's very little cutting.
Yeah.
You couldn't have that style now. You have to cut all the time.
Yes.
The camera never sits still anymore. It's always moving, even when there's no reason for it to move. And sustained scenes of dialogue, where dialogue is at the forefront of the scene, rare. Contemporary filmmaking.
Woody Allen exemplifies
yeah. another style of filmmaking from an earlier period. A kind of thoughtfulness, the importance of acting, the importance of dialogue. His camera doesn't move all the time unless it needs to.
Yes.
The cliches of contemporary filmmaking are it's nothing but sound and explosions and movement. Dialogue is not important. You can't even hear it in these blockbuster films, the comic book films, which are monstrous, but those are the flagship films that are making the all the big money. Very different from the films that we can see from the past. Even the films that weren't successful in the past, or even weren't that good, the style of filmmaking was different. Now films are addressed to younger audiences, not to older folks. There are very few films for older people. And dialogue has been deprioritized. It's all about action, momentum, sound effects, special effects. I tell students, let's ban special effects and CGI for the next 20 years. And let's pretty much cut out camera movement and editing and go back to basics. Have the camera there looking at characters speaking. There's nothing more cinematic than people talking. And the camera just observing discreetly as people are talking.
Oh, Now, as you just said, that Claudia, my lovely wife, who is from a little town outside Bogota, Colombia, just said, that's what we do. We show people talking, and we're going to keep that alive on our show. But there's something so humanizing about the kind of film you're talking about and the kind of films you champion. They bring a sense of humanity. And, like, for example, when I watch this film, Husbands and Wives, with my students, I'm sitting in the back of the classroom, and I see a kind of glow, a kind of transcendence. The students are transfixed, and they're watching people talking, and they're watching male characters be vulnerable. You know, he talks about the main character, his name is Gabe, in that film, says several times, I feel confused, I'm upset, I feel confused. Now, you never hear these stars of today say anything that goes beneath that shallow veneer, that phony masculinity, that I'm in charge and I'm all that. And so people being human, we're losing that in our culture. That's our fear. So I think maybe we have to go back to the past if we're going to go forward. And it could be that we're moving towards a dark age of cinema.
We're in a very dangerous part. Will there be cinema,
yes,
as we define it, in years to come? You said the 20th century was the century for the film,
yeah,
and that's true.
Yeah.
Who knows what the 21st century is going to bring in terms of technology? There may be no movie theaters. It may be everything will be downloaded. We may never have to leave our houses. We can see everything on our iPhones or smartphones. That technology is a threat to cinema, as it is a threat to book culture.
Yeah.
We can be too advanced technologically and lose the certain kind of humanism that you're talking about, and that Woody Allen's films at their best celebrate. My favorite is not Husbands and Wives. My favorite Woody Allen film, and I love to show it, is Crimes and Misdemeanors.
Oh, I love that one.
Because that one really has moral complexity. I mean, that's fascinating. I haven't stopped thinking about it since I've seen it.
Yeah.
A man commits a crime.
Okay.
He arranges for his mistress to be killed.
Yes.
And is he punished for it? No. Does he suffer? Ultimately, he forgives himself and he moves on. His life is glorious. That's very troubling. And Woody Allen wants it to be troubling. He wants us to think about the consequences of actions. And can we forgive ourselves for having committed a blasphemous act? Is he talking about himself? Probably,
yeah.
But is he in some ways reflecting larger issues of choice and moral action that we all confront? But these are serious themes in Crimes and Misdemeanors, which I think is his masterpiece. That's the one I would urge people to see and talk about and think about. It's a very disturbing film.
I think there ought to be more places where people could watch films and then talk about it afterwards. I just finished reading a book about Amos Vogel, who created this Cinema 16 in New York, which was a place where people would talk about film and have lectures about film. And there was a society, the first film society in the United States, actually. But I want to talk a little bit about this beautiful apartment that we're in of yours. It's like a unbelievable feeling of film history. I'm looking at Greta Garbo and Anna Karenina, this life wall-size a movie poster. There's Greta Garbo with Robert Taylor. Sitting on Greta Garbo's rug. My goodness, I hope, you know, please forgive me. But so talk a little bit, and there's curtains. Greta Garbo's lamp behind us over there. Okay, this is amazing. So you've really immersed yourself in film culture, and the objects of film have permeated, you know, your life and your world here. This, as we walk into your apartment, there's this curtain, as if you're coming onto the stage, onto a stage. I know. Foster, did you ever have any fantasies about being involved in film at any time, as an actor, as a director, or?
Isn't that terrible? No, I remember being a kid and typing up reviews of movies. So I guess the critical point of view or the critical stance was deeply embedded in me from the earliest period. And, well, did I want to make movies? No. I met a friend of mine from high school. I hadn't seen her in 50 years, and she saw me do an event in Los Angeles, and she came up to me afterwards. She said a wonderful thing, because I hadn't seen her in all that time. She said, "You did exactly what you wanted to, didn't you?" Isn't that nice? And she was right. I thanked Sally for that. She said, you did exactly what you wanted to. Yeah, I always want to be a critic and to have my opinions count. And I guess to be in a position of some cultural power or influence as a writer and as a teacher and as a host and moderator. You've seen me at the Film Forum in Lowe's, Jersey. And so people listen to you, and they even if they disagree, they might think about it later. Well, maybe he had something there. Maybe what he said I might think about, even if I don't agree with it right now. So, no, I never wanted to write films. I never wanted to be in films. I'd, certainly not as an actor or even as a director or as a screenwriter. I wanted to do just what I'm doing, teach and write and talk.
And, you know, there's a word in education philosophy called agency, which is to have a sense of agency means to be an actor in your own life, to be able to move through the world, to be unstuck, to make choices and act on them. So I'm sort of exploring this whole sort of in-between zone between acting in your own life and acting in movies. And you, sir, give us a sense of agency when you're on the stage and you're talking about film. You make it approachable, you make it accessible, you make it exciting and interesting. You are welcoming me into the salon of film culture in a way that's, you know, maybe some other critics might be more forbidding or maybe, you know, like you're afraid you're going to say the wrong thing. Or
sometimes in my field, in academics, there was a time in the 80s and the 90s when French theory was very, very popular and it had a great allure for academics. Yeah. And there was a lot of jargon. And that jargon got into the writing and to the teaching. And you could read some of those books and you said, well, they're talking about movies, but I don't know what they're talking about because the language is so dense, it's impenetrable. And I thought, well, is that the idea to sort of establish a secret society with this very thick, jargon-clogged language based on French theory, which is very dense and hard to follow? And that doesn't bring people in. It keeps people out. It excludes. So I'm glad to hear you say, because I've been criticized sometimes by the Academy, oh, he's a popularizer, or he makes it's journalistic, it's not criticism, it's not academic. I had some trouble at school when I published a book on Woody Allen. They said, well, you didn't connect Woody Allen to the classic tradition of Horace and Juvenal from the ancients. So you're just writing, you're writing journalism. So I felt that my job is to make film study attractive to people who are interested, but not to speak about it or write about it in such a way that it's forbidding and keeps you out. And there was a time when some of my colleagues in the Academy did do that. They were very drawn by the advanced French theory. Not that the French theorists have nothing to tell us. They do. But sometimes in a language that's just forbidding. For me as well, I can read a sentence. I think I know English. I can't follow this sentence. It would go on. The idea was to make the syntax impenetrable and difficult, and to throw lots of big fancy words. I will use those words in the classroom sometimes and define them. I wouldn't dare use them at the Film Forum or Lowe's, Jersey. Of course not.
I want to give a shout out to my grandmother, Elsie Martucci, who lives in Fort Lee, New Jersey, and who loves movies, and she's 94 years old, and some of our best conversations, whether on the phone or in person, have to do with movies, and have to do with Turner Classic movies in particular, which she loves to watch, my wife and I, Claudia, love to watch, and then I'll call my grandmother and say, hey, you know, you're watching Turner Classics, put this on, and also Robert Osborne does a wonderful job of introducing the film and giving you the context of it, you know, and he
talk about having a touch that brings you in.
Yeah.
Robert Osborne, I'm a huge fan of his. Yeah. He has a wonderful light touch. He never gets in front of the material. He brings you into the material, but never heavily or too seriously, just enough to entice you, but he doesn't get in the way. So he's terrific at his job. I think he's wonderful.
And Turner Classics is providing that education in a way across the country. So I love to watch it because I feel like other people are watching it too. This idea, like when you go to the movies, it's wonderful because other people are watching it. In a culture that's become so fragmented, so niche-focused online and people atomized and alienated, it's great to know that the country or lots of people are watching the same film. And then, you know, we could have conversations about that film.
TCM is doing just what we're talking about, helping us to recover our rich film history. And they show not only the canonical films, the classics, but some of the minor films from the 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. And it's important to know those too, to have a rich sense of the complete history. Mm-hmm. And TCM is of invaluable importance in acknowledging film history. We get to see films, often they show films that are not available in any other format, so they are a classroom that America goes to. They have a huge following, thank goodness. And their TCM festivals every year in Hollywood are world-class events celebrating the history of cinema.
You know, looking around at this apartment, I could just imagine some of the conversations that have gone on and that going on in this apartment. Talk about your own life in terms of talking about film with others.
Well, I'm talking about films with others all the time. I'm also, it's not relevant to this conversation, a huge theater buff. So I believe in Broadway, and I believe in the tradition of the American musical theater. Mm. And I often talk as much about theater as about film. I'm working now on helping Hal Prince to update his memoirs, and of course he's the most celebrated producer-director of the American theater, 22 Tony Awards and counting. So he's, in terms of theater, he's the equivalent of TCM, because he thinks it's so important for young people in the theater to know about their forebears, to know about the great composers and playwrights and directors and producers and actors who came before them. He said, how can you work in the theater now and not know about Rodgers and Hammerstein, and not know about who came before Rodgers and Hammerstein, Rodgers and Hart and Gershwin and Irving Berlin? To work in the musical theater now, you should have a complete sense of the history of that American art form. Same thing for TCM and American movies. Know what came before. What came before is often better than what's going on now. Does it mean there are no great plays now? Not true. No great movies now? Not true. They're there. Yes. Rarely, when they come, we love to embrace them. They're there, but mostly it's pretty disappointing work.
Well, I'm not the only one who thinks that, you know, because sometimes it feels like, you know, being a curmudgeon or just not being with it, you know. But I think about the fact that cultures rise and fall, right? And for example, you had the Roman Empire, you had the Greek culture that rose and fell, the Roman Empire rose and fell. We had a long period of the Middle Ages, Dark Ages culturally, which came to an end when they excavated those wonderful texts, you know, from the Middle Age, from Greek antiquity, and they rediscovered Plato. I wonder if 1,000 years from now they'll be digging through the rubble and come across Raging Bull, or, you know.
I think our great films of the 20th century will become cultural totems in the future, and they will be looked back on, I hope, and recovered as important works in their field. I do think so. They'll be the equivalent of the great novel of the past, you know, or the great critical work or the great historical work. The best of them, I think, will stand the test of time. But when I'm writing now about the 50s, yes, I feel enough time has gone by so that when I say a film like On the Waterfront or a film like Hitchcock's Rear Window is great, we can say it's really important because so many years have gone by and those films still connect to us. They hold their own, but they don't look dated. They still have a cultural and artistic vibrancy, and they speak to audiences when audiences give them a chance.
Well, you educate us to be able to think about films in a deeper way and to learn and maybe even change our own lives based on what we see in the film and to have a true transaction with that work of art.
I like that word.
A transaction. So the idea is that the secret or the truth is not in the film itself and it's not in us, but it's in something that happens in between. But if we could then talk to other people and get ideas and thoughts and just have a real dialogue, we would love to have you come back on the show in the future, sir, and also be part of a roundtable dialogue with others and to keep that quality of discourse alive, of intellect concerning the art of film and the possibilities going toward the future. We're always concerned about the future with what might be. One of my favorite quotes is by an education philosopher named Maxine Green, who said, "We need to think of things as if they could be otherwise. Think of things as if they could be otherwise." And that imagination comes from encounters with the arts. I'm going to give you the last word, sir, and tell us a little bit about your future plans. And starting with today, you're going to be at the Film Forum today.
I'm going to be at the Film Forum and Lowe's, Jersey, doing what I enjoy doing, okay, sharing great films with new audiences. Okay. But my 50s project, which is going to be published by, I'm proud to say, Alfred Knopf, America's number one publisher. Okay. That's the publisher I've been working with for 10 or 12 years now. Okay. So I think of it, magnum opus sounds too grandiose, okay, but the 50s are a very important period in American culture and American history, and the movies are of that period are very significant in terms of showing us the politics of the time, the emotional temperature of the time, the culture of the time. So my efforts now and in the foreseeable future are about making that period come alive for new audiences and new readers when the book is published. So that's what I'm focused on. Hollywood in the 50s. And my engagement is with that period. As I'm working on the book, I keep encountering myself because I keep thinking of the films that I saw in the 50s, and I'm actually looking at them now in a double focus. I'm looking at On the Waterfront, remembering how I reacted to it as a kid, and now remembering how I reacted, reacting to it as a writer and historian and as a teacher. 61 years later, can you believe it? It's 2015, that film came out in 54. 61 years later. How does it look? How do I react to it now as opposed to how I reacted to it then? So this book is an encounter with my younger selves from where I am now.
We're going to have to bring you to Hoboken sometime and have you talk about it over there. So this has been such a delight, such a pleasure. I hope this is only a beginning of our dialogue. There's so much I didn't ask. There's so much yet to be said. The conversation will go on. We are in the Greenwich Village apartment of Mr. Foster Hirsch, one of the leading film historians, critics, and film thinkers in the world, and film educators. It has been such an honor, sir. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks.